Well, so good morning all. Last week we started planar kiting structures and we discussed about these substrate parameters and then different types of kiting structures, mostly the popular kiting structures. And in this series, the kiting structure which came first is the strip line. Then we discussed about microstrip line, its electric and magnetic field distributions, how it looks in the EM mode, then about the effective dielectric constant and how it varies with frequency and why it varies, then its high frequency limitations. After that, we also did for CPW line. Now we are discussing a special guiding scenario where two microstrip lines are parallel to each other, and then we can analyze this in using even an odd mode. Please switch off your microphone. Well, so we are continuing with this even odd mode case for a coupled microstrip line structure. And in this case, as we have seen, the field distributions are completely different in these two different modes. So in the even mode, what we do? In even mode, we excite these two microstrip lines in the same phase. We connect the RF signal with same phase. And in the odd mode, they are out of phase. And because of that, electric and magnetic field distributions are different. Also, we have seen that in even mode, effective dielectric constant is higher because of its field configuration. And from the field analysis, we concluded that if we remove the ground plane, this one, in that case, it can't support any wave propagation in even mode condition. But in odd mode, we still have electric field between these two lines without the ground plane. And we call this special scenario as the coplanar strip line, which is popular in silicon technology for differential circuits. It has other names, not only just odd mode, we also call it a balanced mode for the coplanar strip line case. Now we are continuing our discussion, and let me show some plots. So white port material, it can't record, so you have to note it down in your copy. Well, so I am drawing a coupled microstrip line configuration. These are the two strips and sitting on ground plane. Now let's say we are exciting them in even mode. Now, if I draw the induced current Js on the structure, so for a single microstrip line, as I said, that because of this discontinuity at these two ends, current is highest here. And if I plot now the current component for a single microstrip line, it looks something like this. Okay, this is the induced surface current, Js, how it varies along its width. Now, if I consider the same thing here in even mode, it is somewhat similar to electrostatic scenario, and we have higher concentration on the outer edges. So, if you look at this tip, it decreases in the inner side. This is in even mode. And in the odd mode, it is just the opposite. So we have the coupled microstriplined system, and now we are drawing JS in odd mode. So this is the current density, surface current density, JS. And because of different epsilon E, yesterday we discussed that in even mode, let's say epsilon EE, it is higher than epsilon E in odd mode. And because of that, we have dispersion, because phase velocities are different. And now if I consider a general scenario where we don't have 0° phase difference between these two RF sources, or 180° phase difference between these two RF sources, in that case we have both of this even mode and odd mode, and then we have dispersion, which we can avoid. Well, so okay, let me show one more picture. So in time domain, how your pulse look? So this is from my own FDTD code. What I'm doing here, I'm considering two parallel microstrip lines which are coupled to each other. I did not show the ground plane, so it is with the ground plane. Now I'm connecting to RF generator, one to the first microstrip line, second one to this second microstrip line. And when we do that, let's say the RF generator, it's sending pulse, Gaussian pulse, and I'm drawing the normal magnetic field. That means y is the propagation direction, z component just below this metal strip. So at t equal to 0, then Gaussian pulse peaks here at the RF source end, and as time progresses, then it travels in y direction, it propagates in y direction. So after some time, when the pulse location is exactly at the middle, then it is the plot in even mode. So that's why EZ, both of them are in the same direction. So if you look carefully here, you see these two tips from Kulaev simulation, how it looks. But the difference is not that clear. So I said that inner tips will be down compared to the outer tips. So in the event mode, outer tips is little higher than the inner tips. So again, after some time, this pulse, it reaches port 2. Now we are doing in the odd mode. In odd mode, since the direction of EZ is different, so that's why in one side it is positive, for the other microstrip line it is in negative direction. So what I am drawing here, it is the EZ component just below the strip. Well, let me see, if I zoom in, then that difference is visible or not? Okay, this difference is very small for this situation which I chose here. So inner tips should be down compared to the outer tips. Now, as I said, that we face problem because of different dielectric constants under these two different excitation schemes, then how to avoid dispersion? There are three standard techniques. The first technique, we use a zigzag path inside the structure. Considering that epsilon E in the even mode is more than epsilon O in the odd mode, and also the current distribution, it is higher at the outer edges. So that means if I introduce any sort of perturbation along this coupling edge, inner edges, then it is mostly going to affect the odd mode. Why? Because I said current distribution is higher here at the inner edge. And if I introduce any perturbation at the outer edges, that is going to affect mostly the even mode. Not only that, if I introduce any structure in the ground, then since in even mode, most of these field components are from strip to ground, then this ground perturbation is going to affect my even mode configuration. And in addition to that, you see, since epsilon E is higher, then lambda G is smaller in even mode. What that means? That means, let's say, 1 centimeter of length represents one guided wavelength at some arbitrary frequency, let's say 10 gigahertz in the even mode. Then the same length, 1 centimeter at the same frequency, 10 gigahertz, it will represent a smaller length, less than lambda G. Why? Because here epsilon E is less. Now lambda G, that is equal to lambda naught by root epsilon. Then I have, if I can increase the effective path for the odd mode and make it equal to even mode, then that dispersion effect is gone. So I follow that logic. And then we come to the first solution. So which is, let me better draw it. Current distribution already we noted down. Now we see that if 1 centimeter of length, it represents lambda G in even mode at some arbitrary frequency F naught, then this same length will be, it will represent less than lambda G in odd mode at the same frequency. So we have to make them equal. Then what we can do, we consider the top view. We have two coupled microstrip lines. And we know that at the outer edges, the current distribution is mostly due to even mode. So I want to make it longer in the odd mode. So what we do, then instead of using this straight line, we use perturbation like this. So this is to effectively increase the current path . So now what we have to do, if I zoom in this part, so this delta L, it's looking like a group structure, and delta W, let's say, we need to adjust so that lambda G in even mode and in odd mode, it becomes same. So this is the first technique using perturbation for phase velocity equalization. Then what can be other technique? So why it happens, if I go back and look at the field distribution, then it happens because of presence of air. It becomes an inhomogeneous structure, and a component is in air, another part inside the dielectric material. So if I can put a dielectric overlay here, let's say with some higher dielectric constant, so that we can make them equal, noting that in the odd mode, we have more field components in here. So if I put epsilon r here, we need to optimize the thickness and epsilon r of this overlay. And then there is a possibility that I can increase the effective dielectric constant in odd mode. Why in odd mode? Why not in even mode? Because for the odd mode, we have more field components inside here, not in even mode. So that is the second technique. Then what is the third technique? So this third technique actually we invented 10 years back, 10, 13 years back. So from again the field concept, if I put any perturbation here, then it disturbs mostly the even mode. I did not refer to my paper anyway. So what we did, we put a ground plate slot here, a ground plane slot. Okay, now this slot width, we need to adjust to make these two VPs same. And it is going to affect mostly the even mode. So last year we discussed, if I put a slot below the structure, but at the same time, what will happen, even mode impedance will decrease because we are going to disturb the even mode. And we already discussed last year that if we don't have any ground plane, then it can't support any even mode. Even mode impedance becomes infinite. So that's why if I put a slot in the ground plane, so it has an issue that Z0E increases. So we can actually use that in our advantage. Later, when we'll discuss about coupling, there we'll see coupling depends on the ratio of Z0E to Z0O. So as the difference is more, then we have more coupling. So this third technique, it provides me one advantage that in addition to make these two phase velocities same, it can also give me increased coupling. And what is the other way, conventional way to increase coupling? I say that the coupling is determined by the separation S. So you have to make it smaller for improved coupling. Now, last day, one of you were asking about this capacitor representation. In transmission line form, in distributed form basically, we represent a lossless transmission line using a lumped inductor and lumped capacitor. Inductors are in series, capacitors are in shunt. Now I am considering cross section. So in the even mode, we don't have any electric field coupling between these two. So this C11, C22, it represents two microstrip line, basically two lossless transmission line. So in the propagation direction, I'm not showing the L basically. I'm considering a cross section of them. But in the second case, in odd mode, since we have electric field components between two strips, we have one mutual capacitance, C12 or C21. So it is symmetrical reciprocal network. So that's why C12 is equal to C21. Now, in D.M. Pucher's book, he represented it with respect to that PEC, which we could place in the central plane. And then he represented like this mutual capacitance, twice C12 in series with another twice C12. So that the effective capacitance between these two becomes C12. So in the distributed form, since the characteristics impedance, it depends on L and C, characteristics impedance becomes different in one mode. Usually in all the structures for microstrip line case, Z0E is always more than Z0O. Even mode characteristics impedance is more than odd mode characteristics impedance. Well, so next we are going to start a new topic. It is the surface wave. So surface wave phenomena, it becomes more prominent at higher frequencies, when particularly the thickness of the substrate, which is represented by twice D here, it is comparable or near to the wavelength, guided wavelength, lambda g. So to avoid surface wave, we use a thumb rule that twice D should be less than 1 by 100. So 100 times less than lambda g. At higher frequencies, in most of the cases, actually you can't maintain that. Okay, so you calculate lambda g and what is the 100th of it, and your height or thickness of the substrate should be less than that. At lower frequencies, it can be easily achieved. So that's why we can neglect simply surface wave, but which we can't if you go particularly X band and above. X band is 8 to 12 gigahertz. Now we discussed two different scenarios. Looking at the guiding structure, sometimes we are using one side copper, sometimes we are using both side coppers, like microstrip line. So that's why we start with a simple dielectric slab. So a single dielectric slab, it can support both TM and TE mode. And why we call it surface wave? Because if somehow this mode is excited at one point, then it travels through the dielectric material. And if I take, let's say, big dielectric material to design a PCB, 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter, then we don't have any control over this surface wave mode propagation. So from the source, it will propagate everywhere along the surface inside the PCB, but it will remain inside that. And when it comes to edge, where it sees air, a part reflects back and another part radiates. So that's why for antenna structure particularly, it becomes a problem. So because this radiation, we don't have any control. It depends on many other characteristics. So usually antenna engineers, they try to avoid surface wave, that's why. Well, so we are not going to do any analysis for the surface wave scenario, just we directly jump to the solutions and discuss about the electric and magnetic field distributions inside this dielectric slab. We assume here wave is propagating in Z direction. So we consider wave is propagating in Z direction. So then the substrate, it lies in YZ plane according to this notation. And you see, we consider origin on central plane, middle plane. Well, so if I consider TM mode, so another information. So here, not just here, whenever we use two dielectric materials, you remember this point. Whenever we use two dielectric materials, we have always hybrid mode generation. So here also we are using two dielectric materials. One is epsilon R, another one is air, inhomogeneous medium. So here also, just like microstrip line, we have hybrid mode generation. So that means we have to deal with all the six components of electric and magnetic fields. Now, we can do some simplification. You recall, for microstrip line, looking at the field values, we concluded that since the field components in the direction of propagation is much smaller, then we can simply neglect it. And that's why we call it TEM mode. Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
Sorry, tell me.
Sir, somebody is removing me continuously. Like, can you make everyone as an attendee? So
No, that I made before starting.
Everyone was present, sir.
Yeah, here I everyone by default is present. I can see 115. Maybe you installed software in two different sources, then you have to use one of them only. Do not switch on both your mobile phone and laptop. Anyway, I'm coming back to the Surface Web. I think you can see my slide still. If you can't, then please comment. Anyway, so we are considering the dielectric slab and we were discussing about the hybrid modes. Now, in this case, if we look into the FINT component, we can make one approximation. We see that H, Y, E, X, and E, Z components are dominant compared to other three field components. And since it is only H, Y, which is perpendicular to direction of propagation, we call it TM mode. So better to say it quasi TM mode then, because we know that it is a hybrid mode. Anyway, so we did the simplification looking at the field components. So for TM modes, it is easier to proceed with HY since we have only one magnetic field component. In this case, we may have two different types of modes. The first group we call symmetric mode, and the symmetric mode is represented by cos PX. So P is the X directed wave number. And where we choose X, it is on the mid plane. So that means at X equal to 0, all of these modes has maxima, HY maxima on the mid plane. If you go up or down, it will decrease sinusoidally. Now what happens in air when X is more than D? It decays exponentially. Now we have another group, anti-symmetric mode. Here it is represented by sine px. So all of these modes have zero on the midplane. Let me show you the plot for TM modes. So this is the plot of HY. You see on the midplane, it is highest for TM naught, and then it decreases sinusoidally inside the dielectric and in air exponentially. The next higher order mode is TM1, which is anti-symmetric. On the mid plane, it is HY is 0, then it varies like this. Well, we have TM naught mode, which has no cutoff frequency. So we are not going through any analysis, just the mode characteristics. The same is true for TE modes. Now, in this case, you have to just replace all the electric field by magnetic field. So we don't have to repeat the analysis again. You see here EOI, HX, and HG. So we now put the relationship for EOI. For the symmetric modes, it is again highest here on the mid plane. And for anti-symmetric mode, it is 0. So it will have similar plot, just like HY, but now it is the EOI component. Maximum on the central plane for E0 mode, and for the next higher order mode TE1, it is 0 on the central plane. So let us discuss about the cutoff frequencies. TM naught and TE naught mode has no cutoff frequencies. They can be supported even at megahertz or kilohertz frequencies, but as we decrease the thickness compared to lambda g, we say that coupling window decreases, then generation of surface wave mode reduces unless it is near to lambda g or comparable to lambda g. For other TM and TE modes, we have the same expression for cutoff frequencies. It is given by twice T by lambda naught, that is equal to m by 2 into epsilon r minus 1 to the power half. M represents the mode numbers, and twice T is the thickness. Well, next, grounded slab. So we have a dielectric slab, other side it's completely copper cladded. And if we go through the analysis, again we see, first of all, it will be hybrid modes. But looking at the field strength, we can approximate it by TE modes and TM modes. Now for TM modes, we have the EZ component, EX component and HY component. Well, I think I changed the perpendicular direction. No, X, Z, okay, it's fine, it remains the same. So Z is the propagation direction and the substrate lies in YZ plane. But here we are considering the origin on ground plane. Now EZ then, it is in the direction of propagation. So on the ground plane, we don't expect any EZ component. So it is, because you see, within 0 to t, it is represented by a sinusoidal term. So at x equal to 0, whatever may be the value of A, it becomes 0. And then it increases sinusoidally, and inside air, it decreases exponentially. It is given by e to the power minus h x minus t. So it decreases exponentially. What about the EX component? EX is perpendicular to ground. And this is highest on the ground because we have now two sinusoidal terms. So this is highest on the ground. And then it will go up, it decreases sinusoidally. In air, it decreases exponentially because of this term. So we have EZ component in the direction of propagation and EX component, which is perpendicular to ground. Well, these are the cutoff frequency expressions. So again, for n equal to 0, we can have TM0 mode. It has no cutoff frequency. For other modes, we have cutoff frequency. So it is then related to the thickness of the material. The dielectric constant of the substrate and then the mode number. Well, next it is TE modes. So for TE modes, you see here magnetic fields, they have similar expressions like electric field components. Well, if I look at EY variation, then for TE mode, EY, what is this direction? It is parallel to air dielectric interface and perpendicular to propagation direction. So for the EY component on ground, then it is tangential, which should be zero. And if I look at the expression, it is zero. So on the ground plane, it is zero. If you go up, it increases sinusoidally. And in air, it decreases exponentially. It has the same, it was NC, and in this case it is twice N minus 1 into C. So we have a different expression for the grounded dielectric slab. For dielectric slab without any metal, we have the same expression. Now, but here we can have a TE0 mode also, which has no cutoff frequency. Well, now let's see why they are important and for what type of guided structures they are becoming very important. The most important one is TM0 modes. That creates problem for microstrip line. You compare this geometry with microstrip line geometry and how it looks. So here I'm showing cross-sectional plane, XY plane. Now we have mostly the perpendicular field component, right? That means EX component. So if these two fields are in the same direction, we have obvious coupling, which we can't avoid it. So for microstrip line, then we have high coupling or surface wave generation, and that is TM0 mode. So this is the main culprit for microstrip line circuit, TM0 mode. So even if we maintain sufficient separation between two microstrip lines, we can't avoid crosstalk. This is the problem. Because of the surface wave, this crosstalk effect will be always there for any guiding structure, any planar guiding structure. Okay, it's not like rectangular waveguide. In waveguide, it is completely closed structure. So we can place them side by side and we don't have any sort of crosstalk between these two. So in measurement, it can be exactly zero. But for microstrip line, it can't be. This is a problem. So when we design, let's say, filter, bandpass filter. So in the stop band, what do you want? Attenuation, or better to say isolation. Isolation should be as high as possible. But because of this surface wave, we can't go beyond 60 to 70 dB of isolation. Even if you don't choose your substrate appropriately, what will happen? You will end up with just 30 to 40 dB isolation. Anyway, in most of the applications, 40 dB isolation is enough. But you consider, let's say you are designing a satellite, then situation is completely different. Or you are designing a base station antenna, a base station circuit, then also situation is different. Why? Because for these cases, difference between the transmitted power and receiving power is high. Satellite, a geostationary satellite, it's sitting 36,000 kilometer above. And then the transmitted power should be very high. It is in kilowatt range. Otherwise, you won't weigh anything on surface of the earth. And transmitted power, it is in kilowatt range. And whatever it is receiving, it is below nanowatt. Sometimes it can go to picowatt range. Now consider this difference, 10 to the power 3 to 10 to the power minus, let's say, 11, minus 12. It's huge. So the requirement of isolation, requirement, it can be more than 120 dB, which simply not possible in a planar structure. So that's why for most of the satellite applications, either they have to use waveguide in the transponders, particularly waveguide based structures, or when they are using the transmitter, they have to switch off receiver. Why? Because a part will be leaked to the receiver side, and that will saturate your low noise amplifier, the first component of receiver chain. So you can't actually absorb your desired signal, which is much lower than this leakage. So another solution, it can be that you separate the transmitter and receiver and package them in different metal box. So that way, actually, a full duplex system, that way they do. But if you implement in the same circuit, you can't. We face the same problem in RFIC also. In RFIC, the situation actually is worse compared to this PCB case. The space is limited, thickness is too high, we don't have any control, and we have high crosstalk level in RFIC. Okay. Now, what about TE mode? Why I did not consider TE mode for microstrip line? Because if I look here, we have mostly a Y field component, which is perpendicular to direction of propagation and parallel to interface. So if I now go back, you check EY, it is parallel to air dielectric interface and perpendicular to direction of propagation. Z is the direction of propagation. So EY, now if I compare for microstrip line case, so that means EY, it looks like in H direction. So basically EY is orthogonal to microstrip field lines, electric field lines. Since it is orthogonal, there won't be any excitation of TE mode unless you use any discontinuity. So that's why last year we discussed, usually we don't have any TE type surface wave mode for microstrip line. But since we can't avoid discontinuities, what is discontinuity? Impedance step, any sort of perturbation, impedance step, then shorting via open stop, junction, all are discontinuities. So if we have discontinuities, just right at the discontinuities, it is not exactly TEM. So we may have a field components in this Y direction, and then we have obvious coupling. Otherwise, it is not that important. Well, another popular line is CPW line. So let's see for CPW line, which mode, surface mode creates problem. So let us go back for CPW. What happened for CPW? Last we discussed this one, planar CPW. Well, here we have electric field from the signal line to ground, right side also, signal line to ground. So mostly electric field, it is in y direction, right? If I consider the propagation direction, so mostly it is in the y direction, which is parallel to air dielectric interface and perpendicular to direction of propagation. So since this is the scenario, it is not a ground back case. So I have to consider then the dielectric slab case, and we will see where we have EY. So if I consider TE mode, here we have EY component. Then you see, this is the culprit for CPW. Anyway, so for all the guiding structures, just looking at the field configuration, then you can conclude which surface wave mode is creating problem. Okay, particularly when you go for signal integrity, this concept is important. So how to reduce it? Let's say for microstrip line, what we do, we use a chain of metal here, which the separation between these metal gears are small, so that it behaves like one electric wall. So it surrounds your component. And in that way, it stops surface wave mode propagation from input to output side. It tries to force the electromagnetic wave to go through the components. But it is an effective way, and we can improve isolation by another 10 to 20 dB sometimes, but not more than that. So let's say without this you are getting 50 dB, then with this metal chain you will get 60 dB, but not like waveguide scenario. Anyway, now last part of planar type, we learned now different guiding structures. Then what are the different sources of loss? When we have loss, then the propagation constant becomes complex. So we can't neglect alpha. Even though in all analysis till now we considered lossless scenario, but practically we have alpha. So this alpha or loss, it's coming due to dielectric loss, ohmic loss or conductor loss, and radiation or surface wave loss. Also, then magnitude of S11 squared plus magnitude of S21 squared, that is equal to 1 for lossless scenario. But when we have a lossy medium, that is equal to e to the power minus twice alpha L. You see, here we wrote twice alpha L. Why 2, not alpha L? Because we are considering squared. We are equating the power. So electric field is represented by alpha. Well, then how you can determine this alpha or beta? In experiment, we use length difference method. Length difference method for beta already we discussed. So same technique can be applied for alpha also. And then you find the S parameters using a vector network analyzer, and from that you calculate what is the value of alpha and beta. Well, so the first one is dielectric loss. You all know about dielectric polarization, bound concept of bound charge, right? So it is represented by like arrays of tiny dipoles. Now, permittivity, it's a complex quantity. It is represented by epsilon dash, the real part, minus j epsilon double dash, one imaginary part. And this imaginary part provides the loss. Now, why we have a negative sign? The logic is simple: to make loss positive quantity, otherwise nothing. Well, so we consider a time harmonic propagation. So time harmonic means we represent by e to the power j omega t. Now we use Maxwell's curl equation. So we are trying to quantify this loss because of j epsilon double dash. Okay. So we use Maxwell's curl equation, curl H equal to J plus del T del T, right? So J is what? It is the conduction current, where it is not JS. JS, we conduce the induced current in metal. So this is the conduction current inside dielectric material. Now, most of the dielectric materials are very good insulator and sigma is zero. So practically, we don't have any conduction loss from dielectric. Sigma is zero. Well, now we are considering a general scenario. We may have semiconductor also. So we consider a finite value of sigma. Now apply it. So J, conduction current, that is equal to sigma E. And you take now del del T of D. D, you know epsilon E. So in place of epsilon, you put epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash. So now we separate this two components into real and imaginary part. Now you see J equal to sigma E. With this, then the epsilon double dashed, these parameters become real. So whatever we know already, that because of sigma we have loss, then we have one additional parameter coming, omega epsilon double dashed with this sigma, that will also give me loss. And the imaginary part, G omega epsilon dash, we don't have any problem because of that. It will give you the displacement current. So you see, then this imaginary part, when I put in Maxwell's equation, it behaves like sigma. So that's why it provides also loss. Okay. And I said that it depends on the applied electric field. So we have, if we have higher electric field, we have more loss. Now to quantify it, we define a parameter. We call it loss tangent. This is lossy reaction. So basically the lossy part divided by the lossless part. Put the values, omega epsilon double dash plus sigma by omega epsilon dash. So for dielectric material, sigma is zero. Then it reduces to epsilon double dash by epsilon dash. Basically, we see then loss tangent is the ratio of this imaginary part to the real part. Now for semiconductor material, we can't neglect sigma. So in that case, if we keep on increasing frequency, what this expression says? Omega multiplied by something plus something divided by omega epsilon dash. So since we have one additional factor, sigma, if I keep on increasing frequency, loss tangent should decrease. You think? Sigma is constant, we are adding something, omega parameter divided by omega parameter. So loss tangent should decrease with frequency. But practically when we measure it, it actually increases. Why? Because in this expression we assume that epsilon double dash, epsilon dash, they are not frequency parameter, but practically they are frequency parameter. You go back to that substrate chart, you see that what is the value of loss tangent at let's say 10 megahertz and at 10 gigahertz. So epsilon double dash, this part increases with frequency. And effectively, even for semiconductor materials, loss tangent increases. Well, so loss tangent, basically it represents the electrical property of dielectric materials, which we are using for electromagnetic wave propagation. Same thing we define for permeability, but for most of the materials, they are not sensitive to magnetic field. So that's why in most of the cases we neglect, particularly for this dielectric substrate. But when you are using, let's say, ferrites material or nickel based materials, then you have to consider this. And exactly the same thing, you just proceed. We have then delta M, tan delta M, which represents the magnetic loss tangent. It is represented by mu double dash by mu dash. So here are some closed form expressions for CPW. Anyway, next is the conductor loss, alpha C. So conductor loss, this is because of the JS, surface current. So then it is related to the surface resistance, and it's given by beta delta S by 4 Z naught. Z naught is characteristic impedance of the line. Delta S is the skin depth. As skin depth decreases, alpha C increases into DDL of Z naught. So what is this DDL of Z naught? It represents the change in characteristic impedance if all the metal parts are reduced by delta S, DL. So you consider a coaxial cable, then reduced inner diameter, outer diameter by delta L, then you calculate what is the change in characteristics impedance. That is DDL of Z naught. Well, we can represent it in terms of RS surface resistance also, noting that RS equal to 1 by sigma delta S. Now, when we derive this expression, it came from derivation. We consider a smooth surface, no surface roughness. But practically, if you look at any metal surface, they are all rough surface. Now, let's say that surface roughness, let me show a picture here. You see how a practical metal looks. It's a zoomed in picture and electro-deposited copper, and typical thickness, it varies between this, the roughness varies between 0.3 to 0.5 micrometer. 0.3 to 0.5 micrometer, if I compare to the skin depth, sometimes you can't neglect it. So we have a curve fitted formula, closed form expression, considering the surface roughness. So we consider the RMS value of surface roughness is capital delta. Capital delta is the RMS value of surface roughness. Then alpha C dashed, which we should consider for this rough surface, it is the alpha C, which is given by this top expression. Into, we have one additional term, twice pi by tan inverse 1.4 capital delta by small delta is squared. So what we see here, if capital delta becomes comparable to small delta or skin depth, we can't neglect it. And as surface roughness increases in comparison to skin depth, it increases fast. So we can conclude then at millimeter wave frequencies, where skin depth is much smaller, we have more loss, conductor loss. It is coming due to your reduced skin depth plus some additional term, which is because of its roughness. Now roughness is increasing. So you see then, I'm plotting it over 80 to 110 gigahertz. Attenuation constant alpha C only. So if I consider zero, its value somewhere between 2 to 2.2, something like that. Now, sorry, if capital delta is comparable to delta S, then attenuation, alpha value increases by 2 times. So how it varies? So that's why at higher frequencies, loss is much higher. So you remember, don't be confused. One part is due to reduced skin depth, increased surface resistance. In addition to that, we have another parameter which is coming because of the surface roughness. Well, the third one is radiation loss. I don't think we have enough time. Better to take a few questions. So it is actually the loss which is due to excitation of surface wave, and we may have also radiation from the discontinuities. Next I will explain in details. Well, so now let us take a few questions. Am I audible? Then if you have any question, please ask.
Also?
Yes.
This is regarding the laboratory. Mm-hmm. Hello?
Yes, tell me.
I accidentally submitted my assignment in the Tuesday lab slot team instead of the Monday lab slot. I'm in the Monday lab slot. So should I resubmit it, or will you be able to access it from the different team?
Why do you ask this type of silly question? So what do you think? Where you will be evaluated?
So will it be possible for you to like change the deadline? Because I submitted before the deadline.
No. How come? Am I on Tuesday?
I'm in the Monday lab. Hello?
So you submitted in Tuesday slot, you said, no?
Yes.
So am I there?
So I'll go
whatever I have on Monday slot.
So will it be possible for you to change the deadline or maybe count it as?
No, because I am not the teacher for that lab. And for Monday also we can't. It was announced and it is now almost end of this month. It is your third or fourth, I think. Next class will be fourth class.
Okay.
So you still can submit it, but with some penalty, we'll consider it. Any question related to today's lecture? Yes.
Sir, so in the microstep line, where exactly does the surface wave originate? Is it inside the dielectric itself or is it near the boundary of dielectric and ground plane?
No. Why boundary? If I go back, you see for microstrip line, look at the field configuration. Let's say I'm sending some signal through microstrip line. Now, this field components, it is already there for microstrip line. So it will excite the surface wave, okay, right from here. So now it will propagate in this direction, everywhere along the surface or along the substrate. Sometimes that's why people use the term substrate wave mode. Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir. So when we are finding the E field and H field for microstrip line, that doesn't include the surface wave at all.
For microstrip line, no, we consider ideal scenario. You see, when you approach a complicated problem that can be in microwave engineering, in your circuit theory, in communication field, then you decompose it into different parts. For example, in circuit theory, after solving different parts, then you use superposition theorem, right or not?
Yes, sir.
So this same thing here, what we did for even odd mode analysis. So not that only even mode or only odd mode will exist in actual microwave system, but we decomposed into two different groups so that we can easily explain it, the phenomena. In practical scenario, we have both of these two modes, a mixture of that.
Okay, sir.
So finally, it will be a superposition.
Sir, could you repeat why TE mode has a problem in the microstrip line?
No, not TE, TM. So here, actually, what happens if we have two field components which are perpendicular to each other, then one can't excite another one because it has no component in that direction. They are perpendicular to each other. You recall the example I gave for a square waveguide, TE10 mode and TE01 mode. So in that case, we concluded that both of these modes can propagate together inside a square waveguide because they are orthogonal to each other and we don't have any coupling between these two unless you put some perturbation. Same concept here. So we need to check all the surface wave mode which has this, you see, for microstrip line, according to my coordinate, in x direction, we have mostly the field components. Now, which mode has this EX component? So if I go for grounded slab, which we see that this TM mode, it has EX component, right? Not TE mode, but TE, it is EY, which is perpendicular. So for TM mode, we have EX component and we have coupling through this EX and generation of surface wave for microstrip line. Okay. Now, it generates through this perpendicular area along its length. Now, if this area increases, then we have more excitation of Ex. And how this area increases? If I keep the thickness same, now if I increase the operating frequency, so in terms of lambda g, then the area increases and we have more excitation of Ex. We have more surface wave loss. Is it clear now?
Sir, so the TM mode will interfere with the TEM
yes.
mode. That is
exactly right. Yes.
That is why, because both have an EX component.
Yes, that is true.
So we try to ignore the, not use the TE mode.
Exactly. So for microstrip Focus. Line, always we use TEM. We don't use TE or TM. So even for that TEM mode, we have this problem. You recall yes. for coaxial cable or microstrip line or even CPW, for all these guiding structures, we use TEM mode only. We don't go to higher order modes. Otherwise, it is much more complicated. And we will have so many different phase velocities, so we can't avoid dispersion at all. Any other question? Okay, so this Saturday we'll be having one tutorial class on Smith chart and transmission line related problems. So we'll discuss about how to solve. We may not have enough time to solve each and every problem line by line. So how the approach should be, we'll discuss. And after that, you should practice in your room. Why? That is important. Of course, that is for learning. And the second point from your exam point of view also, because next Saturday, we are going to conduct a test. There, we'll divide it into two parts. One is conceptual, like the last test. And the second part will be numerical. And in the numerical part, you will be asked to solve this type of problem. Okay, thank you then. Bye all.